Well, we want to thank you all for coming out today. The kind of book that we've done, that Floyd and his family shared and asked me to write, and they, of course, did all the corrections on it. They belong to the schools. And it's been too long that the big history has been ignored. And it's time to get into the schools, put some pressure on the school board members, and get these kind of books in the schools. And one of the one of the first things that I ran into when I visited Florida was, I'm a documentary filmmaker. And he had some relatives living out on a place called the Owl River. Well, on the map it's a Moreau. On the map it's a Moreau River. He said, don't watch that. On the map it's a Moreau River. And so I went out there and reached to about, just tall, thigh high. I walked out into the reeds. Suddenly, two great big owls came up. One of them landed on the other side, one went down the river. And that's when I knew why it was called the Owl River. The Moreau River didn't say a thing. Just like the Yellowstone River was the Elk River, that's where the Elk came from. The Cheyenne River was the Good River, because it tasted good and the water was clear. The Grand River was a river that was bigger than its banks because it flooded. The native names told what was there. And the renaming of it took a step back from a connection to the land. Very subtle, but it's there. My journey in meeting Floyd and the family started before I was born. My dad was in the 7th Cavalry during World War II. And the drill sergeant used to ask, who won the battle of the river? He said the natives did. That was the long answer. He was punished for it. And I remember I heard this a lot as a kid, and apparently he held a grudge because I'm his son. And he tried to right this wrong during his lifetime. He went to South Dakota to meet with the Lakota a couple times, but only for 1 week periods. And that's not long enough to make a connection. So near the end of his life, he started to write something, and then he got lymphoma. And so on his deathbed, he asked me to do it. Well, at the time, it was in my direction. But he can't say no. So I said I would. This was 1998. I didn't know anybody in the plains. I didn't know anybody in the Midwest. I didn't even know an acquaintance. I was living in Portland, Oregon at the time. And so in that kind of case, I did the only thing I could do at the time. I went on the internet, which was new at that time. That's when dial-up worked sometimes. And I found a name on the internet. It was Eugene Goodkite from the Northern Cheyenne Reservation. So I called him up and I asked him, do you have any stories of that little Bitcoin? He said, yeah. I said, can I come out and get it from you? Sure. So I flew out from Portland to Billings, rented a car, went to Ranger, and I don't think he expected me to show up. Because he showed his lunch in his door in his office. I said, what do you want? I said, well, I'm the one that called about the stories of that little big one. You got it for me? No. Do you know somebody who does? Follow me, and took me to the Dollarite Library, pointed a rack of books, said, read these, and walked away. So I did. I read about 300 books. This book had a theory. This theory ends up in this book over here. Now it's starting to look and become a fact. So the history was all messed up. Even the more revered books like Black Eyed Steve's and Woodman, those gentlemen knew their language. They told to interpret. Told it to an English-speaking person who wrote down what they said. Black Elk and Woodley never had a chance to proofread what they supposedly said. So there's a lot of misinformation in those books, too. And how do I know that? Because Floyd was saying he knew Lakota in English. and they proofread and made corrections for 6 months and then one for 12 years. So I know that from experience, from something I read. As I finished reading this, I became very interested in Crazy Horse. And being a documentary filmmaker, I should tell you what a documentary filmmaker is. It's somebody who doesn't have the money to make a feature film. So I was working on a script, and I was nowhere did any of the books tell who the women were that raised Crazy Horse. None of them. I thought, well, that's been 125 years ago. Somebody knows. And so I got back on the internet in 2001. I found a gym out at the Cheyenne River Reservation, which was between Standing Rock and Pine Ridge. And he said he knew a family that knew the names of Crazy Horse's moms. So I said, well, let's get together. So he said, yeah. So we made an appointment. I flew out to Rapid City, went to Cheyenne River Reservation. And he stood me up. So now I had 3 days on my hands, and I just been studying the history, not the culture, not the spiritual part. So there's a mountain out there named Bear Butte, Sacred Mountain. I thought, well, I'm going to go out there and check it out. And so I went out there, and I had a lot of spirituality and brought me out to the top. So I'm climbing up. Halfway up, my father spoke to me. Now, he'd been gone for 3 years. But he spoke to me, it was him. He said, open your heart. And I knew what that meant. I didn't know the culture or the spiritual side of the Lakota, or I would not be qualified to do a documentary, to write a book, to discuss the Lakota. So I went back. But all the cultures, all the spiritual parts, they all had the ceremonies. They all said the ceremonies are this way. This is the only way. There's no other way. And they were all different. So I thought, I'm going to get to the bottom of this. I had also written that script. That was the best thing I'd ever done. I agonized over every word, every sentence. And I went back over there in 2002. And I happened to meet the head ranger at Bear Butte that year, a guy named Jim Jango. He's still there today. And he's a Dakota. And I told him about wanting to know more about the culture and the spiritual side and wondering what the names of the women that raised Crazy Horse were. He said, I got something for you. And he went and got Debbie Wardle's phone number. And that's Floyd's younger brother. And so I called him. And he said, yeah, we've been waiting for your call. We knew you were coming from the West. Well, I hadn't told everybody where I came from, but it was an invitation, so I went. And that script in my hand, I handed it to Floyd. He read 3 words, threw it on the table, and said, this is garbage. I pretend like it wasn't heard. And those 3 words were that Crazy Horse was from the Kalala Band. It's actually from the Minicosi Band. And so Floyd knew there were all kinds of things wrong with it. Right from the beginning. And he said, we'll tell you the true story if you have a good heart. I thought, well, how am I going to show I have a good heart? I said, I've got an airplane ticket to go home. He said, we'll take you to Sweat Lodge. I thought, good. I went out there and started a fire up. People were bringing wood. And I thought, well, I'm going to help them. So I brought some wood, preached, and I was running with the wood, and I was sprinting with the wood, and preached, and the rest of the all started stood back and watched me. I remember their uncle said, yes, that kind of scares me. They'll go over the top with enthusiasm. Running to Sweat Lodge was a great experience, very spiritual, very cleansing. Those of you who've been in it know exactly what I'm talking about. Anybody who hasn't, I highly recommend. And then afterwards, we got out. Nobody said how my heart had done. We went into the house, we were eating. And the silence was deafening. And I have to say, you know, I wish I knew your language. They said Lakota and prayed Lakota. I wish I knew your language. I would have sang with you. And that same moment, I He had a gun in the square box. He just started the hot rocks and the pitchfork and opened and closed the door. But never would have. He turned to me and he said, "You know, they won't let me in there because I always end up singing Merle Haggard." At that point, I knew that I had been accepted. But that statement crushed the days I was walking with the heel of his boot. And so for the next 12 years, we went out to the all the world history sites. They had a landmark, a reference point, and to have my camera, took pictures for the relatives and friends that couldn't get out there. And during this time, I learned that they knew their genealogy better than anybody I'd ever met. And made me curious about mine. Our book is in Norwegian and German, so the Norwegian publisher marks them. I was able to find my Norwegian roots and my Swedish roots, which is Sicilian language. I found my family from Sweden over there, and my parents and grandparents in Dallas. That was pretty emotional for me. I wasn't always supposed to write this book. Another gentleman was, but he got called to Afghanistan, so they honored me by asking me to write it. And during the time I was working with Floyd and his brothers, they always talked about their grandfathers. And I would wonder what their grandfathers were. How have I met these people? How come they're nowhere to be found? And then one time, Floyd decided to build a new sled lodge. And he said the whole Lakota Nation is going to sled in there. And I remember thinking to myself, that immediately looks like a tight fit. And so we went in there, there'd be 10 of us in there, or there'd be 12 of us in there. I thought to myself, this can't be the whole nation. I never said anything, but I was thinking that. And then one time I went in there, and these five Lakota men came out of the rocks. Now, I don't know if there's anybody in here who's unfamiliar with where sled lodge is. But there's four times when it's dark, there's four times when it's light. So when the doors are closed, it's dark. On the first darkness, the first round, these five Lakota men came out of the rocks. Didn't acknowledge me, just stared into the rocks. Four of them had their backs to me. They said their shoulders in the right. The one on the left was his profile. This was in the first round. They opened the door, the light came in, everything disappeared. I thought, am I really seeing what I'm seeing? So I moved a little bit, just to make sure I wasn't seeing us just right, to see it. And then they closed the door again, and they came back, all five of them. And they were in detail, they were pleasure. The third round, I came back. The fourth round, they were there. By this time, I knew I was seeing what I was seeing. And so when I got out of the sweat lodge, I came up to Floyd and said, "I know what you're talking about. I understand what you're talking about. When you say the whole Lakota Nation is in the sweat lodge." He said, "Yeah. We know what you saw. Because you doubted us, the grandfather showed themselves to you." And so I don't doubt that anymore. By the way, the person on the left, 2 years later, there was an out-of-print book, and on the inner leaf, it was called The Customs Cover. On the inner leaf was a drawing, and that drawing was that person. And that was an old man, Crazy Horse. That was the father. Because it was in such a detail, it's so close to what I see today. Working with the Crazy Horse family has been one of the greatest things that have happened in my life for the past 20 years. And when my father asked me to do this, I took it out as an obligation at first, but now I know what it really was. It was a gift. So with that, I'd like to hand it over to Floyd Clown Sr.